Yeah, I don't know if he really needs an introduction. You've already heard a lot from him. Tom Gardner, co-founder and CEO of The Motley Fool.
Thank you. Yeah. So I'm going to stand up on the podium to make myself feel tall. The title of at least the beginning of my talk is The Golden Tennis Racket. And the Golden Tennis Racket is a racket that was passed to a six-year-old only child who lived in a suburb outside of a city and was lonely when he came home from school every day. He was an introverted boy, and his father competed in a table tennis competition and won. And what his father won was a golden tennis racket, a tennis racket that had been painted gold. And he brought it home, and his son saw it and asked his father if he could have it. And without hesitation, his dad said yes. What happened then changed the course of the sport of tennis and changed the life of this six-year-old boy. And that is that he took that tennis racket into his backyard, which was a very small yard, but there was a garage and a garage door. And every day after school, when he got back, with not many friends in the neighborhood and no siblings to play with, he took the tennis racket and he began hitting the ball off the garage door. Now, the garage door was not flat wood. It had ridges and grooves so that when he hit the ball off the door ricocheted in different directions, and he taught himself to chase it down. How quickly could he get to the ball? Could he get to it before it bounced a second time? Before it bounced even once, maybe, in some situations? And he did this every day. He did this every day for hours at a time. This person was living in a suburb of Stockholm, Sweden, and his name is Bjorn Borg. He then went on in his first couple years in the backyard, never once played organized tennis. Didn't even really fully know what tennis was. And he had an opportunity in middle school to take a tennis lesson. And the lesson that he took, the coach of the tennis team called the tennis pro to come watch him practice. He was so blown away by what he was seeing, because little Bjorn was able to get to every ball on the court running around. And that golden tennis racket led to Bjorn Borg's performance as a tennis player, which is that in Grand Slam singles tournaments, he won 41% of every tournament that he entered. And he has a higher winning record across all surfaces as a tennis player than anyone in the history of the game. So why am I telling you about Bjorn Borg this evening? I'm telling you about Bjorn Borg because I believe that everyone here has the opportunity to hand that golden racket to someone in your family, and that racket is the joy of investing. And that is really something that we have been working at for the last 20 years. 20 years of trying to grow the love for investing. And what we've watched happen is what happened when our father did the equivalent of handing us the golden tennis racket when we were teenagers. And the basic premise of investing was as a game for us as kids. It was completely enjoyable. We didn't even think about market crashes. We just knew that Dad was buying shares of companies, and we had become part owners of those companies. And naturally, and actually there have been studies done to show this, shareholders of companies speak and think more favorably about those companies than they do if they're not shareholders. So in a way, certainly any consumer-facing company that isn't passionate about its individual investors is making a huge, huge mistake. That was actually a mistake that Starbucks was making, our View stock, probably 15 years ago now. We had our radio show, and the news had come out before our radio show that Starbucks had determined, after a little bit of pressure from folks like us, that it was not appropriate to have individual investors on their quarterly conference call. That's the call at which they announce their earnings. And then there's some trading that goes on. And sometimes companies announce everything from, we're not going to do very well for the next year. Or actually, we're being acquired. special, unique announcements can happen on that quarterly call that individuals weren't being given access to. And so we began to put the pressure on Starbucks. CFO was quoted in the newspaper as saying, we don't allow individuals onto the call because we don't believe that they have the ability to grasp the complexity of our business. To which we said on our radio show, no offense, guys, but it's coffee. It's not semiconductor wafer design. It's coffee. And we invited all of our listeners to call Starbucks Monday morning. It was a Saturday, live Saturday, three-hour show. And we did that a few times. That's a very powerful and fun thing to do, I must say. It's like, wow, it's kind of like Dave and I as kids making all the prank calls that we did to every radio station and random phone number that we could in the phone book. Not just us, everyone doing it to Starbucks with us. And within a week, they announced that they were going to have individual investors on the phone call, on the quarterly conference call. And that's the way the markets have been moving ever since. We have the joy of discount brokers charging us less than $10 per transaction. Dave, when you started as an investor in 1988 or somewhere thereabout, maybe 85, what were you paying for a single transaction? Got it. Yeah. So the pricing was not developed in a way to attract the average investor. And all the information was expensive, too. And now so much information and all the data is free online and updated in real time rather than at the end of the day or once a month if you're, or once a quarter if you're the S&P stock guide. So all the information is out there. All the access is there. What's missing is the understanding of how to invest in businesses. And a lot of what's missing, actually, Warren Buffett says, Lou knows so well, that he feels the most important thing he did as an investor was not to gain access to conversations with the executives at those companies or to understand competitive advantages better than anyone. What Buffett said is the single greatest thing he did as an investor is learning how to manage his temperament. And there you are with the line delivered earlier, be fearful when others are greedy and greedy when others are fearful. So there are so many things wrapped up into becoming a great investor. And what we're attempting to do as a company is to hand the golden racket to you so that in your life, if you enjoy investing, you want to spend time in the backyard with the tennis racket in the equivalent of researching stocks with us, awesome. And I definitely think if you have kids, nieces, nephews, grandkids, you got to get them started. A pair of my favorite investors, what they do, they're family investors, they manage a fund, a relatively large fund, is they have basically 20 core positions. And let's just say it's an individual's portfolio. And let's just roundly say you have $50,000 to invest. So you buy 20 different stocks with that portfolio. But what they do is that 20 stocks makes up about 50% of their portfolio. And then they buy 150 other stocks that make up the other 50%. And they were asked, why? And they said, oh, this is the single best way we can learn. Because you really learn when you have skin in the game. So if you want to learn about any company, buy a few shares. You will follow it as if a large portion of your portfolio is in it, even though it may only be $100. So that's a really, I think, important premise for you as an investor is to get in the game, get skin in the game, and learn. I want to close by just mentioning somebody who picked up the golden racket of investing herself. It wasn't handed to her by anyone. And that is a woman you may have heard of that I'm pretty sure Lou mentioned in the book named Ann Schieber. Has anyone heard of Ann Schieber? Okay, great. So I'll tell the long version. It's about an hour and 20 minutes. And picks up in the 75th minute. Ann Schieber worked at the IRS. She was in her early 40s when she recognized that she had not gotten a promotion, and she had seen other people that she felt were not as deserving to get promotions. As you might imagine, for that period of time, those people were predominantly men. She was so frustrated that she quit. She never took a job again. She was also frustrated by another thing in her life, and that is that she had given two separate brokers her savings, and both times they'd blown it, either entirely once or largely. And so she was very frustrated by that. She had a $3,100 pension, and she had $5,000 that she'd saved up. She had not invested in stocks at that point. To be a great investor, You do not need to pick up the golden tennis racket at the age of 6. She picked it up in her late 40s. She then began to invest. Her principles were simple. She bought in the things that she believed in, she knew about. She held them almost forever in certain cases. She added what little savings she could. She would go to shareholder meetings and do something that I recommend, or I guess we'll look for the Ann Scheiber in the room today. She would go to the shareholder meetings with Tupperware. And she would just see what food was left over at the end of the meal there, back there on the table. There's a lot of stuff right there. And she would just put it in the Tupperware, ask if it was okay. And they said, sure. If you look back on the table as you're walking out, just look and say, you know, actually, those chocolate-covered strawberries look pretty good to me. There's about 120 mini sandwiches still left. So she grabbed the food and she would, you know, that's how she thought about the world. In a way, she was a super conservationist. In another way, she may have gone to extremes, too great of extremes in certain situations. But numerically, let's recognize what she achieved. She started with $5,000 and a $3,100 pension, late 40s. She lived until the age of 105. When she died at 105, she surprised the world by giving her entire estate to Yeshiva University that did not know that was coming. And that small $8,000 investment that she had to start had turned into $22 million in her lifetime. Those numbers shock us all until you actually sit down and run them on a calculator and you start to see, wow, it turns out this is just relatively simple math. It's just in our classes in grade school, instead of being taught this very powerful force of compounding applied to savings that could be so incredibly transformative for people, we're learning how to calculate train A leaves Philadelphia and gets to Chicago, train B. How many times did I do that? How many times did I calculate the volume of a sphere and yet never once apply that in my daily life? Perhaps that's you know, my own shortcoming. But the power of compounding is what is able to turn small amount of savings in your late 40s into an incredible sum of capital well beyond what anyone would ever need. Decades later. And those principles are outlined in Lou's book and hopefully throughout The Motley Fool. And Tracy Dahl said to me something that she wanted me to make sure I mentioned here, which had been briefly mentioned before, and that is that our company aspires to be able to answer any question you have at any point in time. We as a staff may not do it, but our community is free. You can post questions about any stock that you have, any strategy that you're trying to understand, how to more effectively complete your taxes at the end of the year, how to get family members to start investing. These discussion groups are all out there at fool.com, and those discussion groups are all free, and you can drop a question and expect an answer usually within 24 hours. So we're here to help you as much as possible, and I know you're here to help us, and we get a lot of great ideas from you, and so I thank you for that. One last little plug, and that is the plug for conscious capitalism, which Alice mentioned, and that is, I just want to outline two principles about it that I think could be useful to you. One of them is that essentially the greatest companies in the world are trying to make all of their stakeholders happy. They're not going to provide incredible stock returns while offering a really poor place to work for their employees. And there are a lot of those companies, by the way. They're also, more than 70% of people who go to work in the U.S. say that they do so indifferent or negative about their business. So that's a terrible statistic. There are certain businesses that do extremely well for their employees and their shareholders, but they're taking advantage of their customers methodically. We can think of those experiences in companies that we've run into. Unfortunately, so many of them are in the world of finance. The truly great businesses are serving their stakeholders and trying to provide A-plus experiences and delight for being a part of those organizations. So if you're looking for great companies to invest, just look around for the companies that people want to be a part of. The companies that you feel like you're a member of their community, even though you may just be buying organic food or books that didn't get delivered on time this holiday season. And see which companies and how they respond. Are they responding in a way that says, hey, we really want you to keep being a part of this. We blew it. Or are they just hoping that that passes and they're moving on to the next thing because they're trying to hit their quarterly earnings numbers and they don't want any give backs. So if you can find those companies where the employees are staying, where the shareholders hold those shares for long periods of time, where The customers go back again and again. You're going to find a business like Berkshire Hathaway that has incredibly long tenure across all of its stakeholders, and you're going to find one of the greatest performing businesses in the world's history. So there are a lot of them out there, and I think conscious capitalism is a good way to search around and find them for yourself. So I think I now, let me guess, that was 4.5 minutes? Probably not. I didn't. No. Thank you, Jesse. I apologize for running a little bit long, but you know, we spend most of our time behind the computer. It's great to see faces. So thank you very much for coming. And here's Allison.